A very good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us at India TV Presents CMO Week, powered by Nickelodeon Sonic. After successfully conducting three events under the All Week umbrella, Television Week, Digipub Week, and Languages Week, we are pleased to announce the next one, CMO Week. To begin with, I'd like to thank our sponsors, presenting partner India TV, and powered by partner Nickelodeon Sonic. Now introducing you to the moderator of the session, Ashwini Gangal. And once again, thank you everyone. Before we start, can we have the AV please?
सत्ताईस साल आपकी अदालत में आपका साथ क्यों? जब सवाल मुस्कुराकर पूछे जा सकते हैं, चिल्लाने की क्या जरूरत है? जब इरादा सीधे सीधे खबरें दिखाने का हो तो लोगों को लड़वाने की क्या जरूरत है? इसीलिए मैंने इंडिया टीवी पर इन सारी बातों का ध्यान रखा, खबरों में, कमेंट्स में, सवालों में, न किसी को बनाने की नियत, न किसी को गिराने की कोशिश। इंडिया टीवी पर शोर कम, खबरें ज्यादा।
थैंक यू, ओवर टू यू अश्विनी।
Thank you very much, Abid. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this session. Warm welcome to all my panelists and hi, audience. I just want to quickly lay down the context of how we arrived at this topic of discussion today, you know, before we begin anything. Now, since March, my team and I, basically a bunch of passionate journalists, reporters, and chroniclers of marketing strategy, have been observing the FMCG consumer markets very closely. And we've feverishly been reporting on every new product innovation, marketing experiment, new product launch, all the diversifications. We've seen how categories were created in record time. And you know, when marketers played around this year, we documented it. So in many ways, it really, for me and my team, I'm sure, it feels as though the last 9 months and all our analysis and observations and study of the last 9 months are somewhat collapsing into this 45-minute session now. And there's no doubt that two subsegments, that is immunity and hygiene, really emerged as the hottest segments of this year. And because don't forget, 2020 is the year that gave us 99.9% germ kill. It gave us Chyawanprash flavored ice cream. So it will always be that year, no matter what happens next year. So I'll just quickly tell you why everybody is on this panel, you know, the people you see in front of you. So Suman, of course, is from Hamdard. She represents immunity. We've got Anuja from Godrej Consumer Products. You represent hygiene with your hygiene portfolio. Nikhil of Signify, again, hygiene. Jayan, of course, I'm going to classify you in both hygiene and immunity because you gave us haldi ice cream, and hygiene because you solved for a hygiene related problem by packaging what used to be a loose product. I'm talking about Panchamrit in temples of India, okay? And of course, Prashant now at Dabur, not many people may know that though he does look after Chyawanprash, honey, and the immunity kit portfolio and glucose at Dabur, Prashant also handles the Dabur hand sanitizer range. So again, I'm putting you under both immunity and hygiene. So a warm welcome to everybody. I can't wait to hear what each of you has to say. I'll begin by inviting you all to give us a quick round of opening remarks. Save all the juice for later. Just take no more than say 1 or maximum 2 minutes to very quickly run our audience through two things. You know, give us a sense of the categories that you represent, and also name the brands and products that have kept you busy over the past 9 months. So just touch upon that, and then I'll move on to pointed questions for each of you. So we can start with Prashant.
Hi everyone, fellow panelists and the audience. Thank you so much for having me here. Thanks AFX and the sponsors. So very quickly, as an opening remark, I would want to just introduce myself and also the brands that have kept me busy in last 9 months. Ashwini has mentioned that, yes, I represent the team that look after Dabur Chyawanprash, Dabur Honey, Dabur Glucose, and there are other other brands that we have launched recently, which is Dabur Immunity Kit, right? Which was actually a kit of different products which was solving the immunity needs of the consumers during this time. We've also launched Dabur Vedic Suraksha Tea, which is again a value-added tea with Ayurvedic ingredients. I also look after skincare, and one portfolio that kept me busy is definitely the hand sanitizer, right? So that's basically what I represent. And as an opening remark, yes, we are here to understand what's next for immunity and hygiene and hear everyone's views. My opening top line view here is that, yes, immunity and hygiene was always there. These needs were always there. Got heightened in the last 9 months. Will settle at a much higher level than it used to be pre-COVID, but because people are much more aware of the needs related to immunity and hygiene. And slowly, gradually, these are the categories which are being part of their lifestyle and their health needs. Yes,
Perfect. I will come back to you, Prashant, with lots of questions. Jayan, why don't you go next?
Thanks, Ashwini. Thanks for the introduction and the pleasure meeting all of you. The pandemic is real and also it's global. So the first time in our lives, we've seen something like happening at the same level, same scale, same terror around the world. And so is the change in the habits and the perception and the adoption of a variety of products pertaining to hygiene and immunity. And we at Amul believe milk is the best form of the most healthy and the natural product, which will help you build immunity, health, wellness, everything. And as the situation changed, we also tried to adapt to changing requirements of the customers. And what we did during this last 9 months, we launched about 60 products. And in this space, but particularly for immunity building, I mean, milk plus immunity ingredients like haldi, tulsi, ginger, ashwagandha, saffron, star anise. I mean, you name the ingredient which is good, we blend it with milk and gave it form of a beverage or gave it form of an ice cream. Or even a chocolate, which is a 3-in-1 chocolate. We have haldi, tulsi and ginger in a chocolate. Apart from that, other goodness of camel milk also we brought to the country with a camel milk ice cream or a camel milk, milk powder or a camel long life milk also. So these are the long-term trends. And as you mentioned about the Panchamrit, how to provide an offering to the people when who go to the temples and require that particular product at this given point of time. So all said and done, entire communication for the last 9 months was built around proving the goodness of milk to the masses, that a packaged milk is safe and healthy. And that's been the overlying theme for the organization in terms of communication all across, and basically not stopping our communication with our audiences even for a minute during this last 9 months. It's a very interesting time, and I hope that we as brands and we as organizations look forward to meeting these requirements, the changing requirements of the customers in the years to come.
That's right. Perfect. Anuja, why don't you go next? Because you've got air sprays that kill germs in the air, you've got surface sprays, and you've also got laundry fabric sanitizer sprays, so and hand sanitizers, of course, with pockets. So you pretty much cover a lot of rooms and types of surfaces at home. So talk about the brands that have kept you busy.
Thanks for the opportunity, Ashwini. Really excited to be here. So to start with, I work with Godrej Consumer Products, and I look after the personal care and the hygiene category. Which largely includes personal hygiene, home hygiene, which also includes kitchen hygiene, and of course, on-the-go hygiene. I think the last 9 odd months, I'd say in hindsight, has been possibly the most accelerated phase of learning for me over my last 16 years in the corporate world. It's taught us not just about how you can go out and challenge norms, when you thought that a new product takes about 16 to 18 months, we challenged ourselves by launching 12 mega categories. And Ashwini spoke of a few, right, from hand sanitizers to disinfectant sprays, wipes, body wash, to fruit and veggie wash, dishwashers, So, you know, the entire gamut, quite literally, over a period of 60 days, while people were working from home and, you know, teams were collaborating together. So I think it's been a big lesson for marketers, as marketers and marketers also as consumers, and people who were decoding consumer needs constantly. So, you know, one, I think, has been we fighting ourselves kind of challenged, you know, norms that we'd always thought to be real. I think the second thing, you know, that personally I have learned across a lot of my brands has been the power of, you know, building trust and power of building authenticity at this time, and how critical that is, you know, for your brands and for your businesses. Of course, it's one important aspect of marketing to have launched and, you know, taken all those products to consumers that they needed. But equally, when it came to brand storytelling and, you know, getting the proposition out to the consumer, how important it was to be absolutely honest, and how important to be was it than ever before was it to be very, very relevant, you know, to the consumer, because I think the consumers can now see through, you know, brands, their intent a lot more.
So. Absolutely. Yeah. Anuja, I will come back to you because I do have a very provocative question on this trust and communication front, which is not difficult to guess, but hold that thought. Suman, can I come to you for your opening remark, please? Suman, can you hear me? Hi.
I think, you know, I'm just sort of dropped and getting disconnected.
That's fine. You know, Suman, I don't know where to begin with the Hamdard portfolio. It's huge and there's so many brands on that list. Talk about the ones that kept you busy more than others. Perhaps we can go back to Suman. Nikhil, do you want to jump in here with your opening remark? We'll go back to someone once her line is
here. No problem. I think Suman is having some connectivity issues. So,
Products that one could really talk about. So, yeah. I really, like you said, we have 600 products and it's not easy to talk about all. Like Prashant, I think we also worked a lot around Chyawanprash, and we worked on immunity kits, and we worked on Kulzam, which is our traditional medicine, and Jishanda, Ayush Jishanda, which is also something that Ayush Ministry recommended for the, you know, the COVID patients to have, or to protect yourself from COVID. So we worked a lot around a range of products around this time. And what was really, you know, good to know was that self-care remained a subject that that was close to everybody's life at this point in time, because COVID has been a wake-up call for everybody to realize that health is indeed wealth.
Fantastic. I'll come back to you. Nikhil, sorry about the confusion. Please go now with your opening remarks.
No problem. Firstly, thank you for having me here. I think it's great to be part of a panel that has such eminent people on the panel, and the topic is so topical. Right now, so I represent Signify Innovations. Most of you would better know us as Philips Lighting. During this time, I think you know, we've been leaders in UVC lighting, and the category that I represent for hygiene is very different from most of the other panelists.
Absolutely,
because unlike you know, we're not an FMCG product truly, but in this time of our crisis, actually. We've been leaders in UVC lighting for 35 years now, and we've been using that technology largely for B2B applications. But beginning of this year, I think after seeing the China crisis, we could see, you know, throughout the world that this would, you know, snowball into something much bigger than what we could see initially as a tip of the iceberg. It was that time, I think, at the beginning of the year that our teams in R&D started working on a UVC product that we could roll out for consumers and consumer homes. It took us some time, but by middle of this year, we launched the UVC disinfection system from Philips, under our Philips brand. And it is that I'm representing here as well. That particular product, you know, so when you get out of your house, you know, you wear a mask, you do social distancing, and then when you get back home, you know, there's a sigh of relief, that's your safe space, right? But there's always an apprehension when you get back home that things that are coming into your house, what do you do about them, right? You're spraying them with sanitizers, you're putting them in a bucket of vinegar, water, and salt water, and trying everything else, right? But without knowing whether that's working or not working, you got to know that on WhatsApp and started doing that. And we basically brought about the UVC disinfection system as an option wherein consumers can now be completely satisfied that, you know, whatever they're bringing in, if they put that in the disinfection system for about 2 to 3 minutes, you know, there's a proven, lab-proven technology that will ensure that, you know, we were talking about 99.9%, a technology that gives 99.9999% kills all viruses and bacteria, including COVID-19. So that's one of the only proven
I will come back to you, Nikhil. And, you know, just for the benefit of the audience, I'll just say it's like this microwave-like box with ultraviolet light in it, and that's what kills germs onto objects that you may stick into that box. Thank you for your opening remarks, everybody. I'll jump right in, okay? My first question is actually at the heart of this subject. I want to understand from all of you whether the last 9 months were enough to crystallize new habits, or whether there's still a lot of work left on that front. Because for better or for worse, what I see happening, whether it's anecdotally or, you know, with data, there's a sort of psychological homeostasis. That's what I like to call it, because anxiety has swung back to pre-COVID levels. It spiked in the middle and now it's going back. So if not all the way, at least somewhere halfway. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, but it's not good either. So the question for all of you really is, you know, you rode a wave. A lot of the products that you sold successfully this year were tied to a mass consumer sentiment of anxiety and insecurity. Consumers leaned on your products to feel safe and to feel strong. But what then happens to the longevity of quote-unquote pandemic products? As marketers, how are you going to solve for that as behavior patterns stabilize or normalize? And the second part of that really is, do we now need to repurpose these products? Because we saw that happening to some extent with existing products like air purifiers and air conditioners. Never mind what they were born to do. In 2020, they killed viruses. Never mind temperature control and removing pollutants from the air. So if they repurposed, do pandemic products now need to do some sort of reverse repurposing for 2021? So I'd like your thoughts on this. Anuja, we were discussing this the other day. Why don't you go first?
Sure. So Ashwini, I think, you know, you sort of very rightly mentioned that 9 months may not necessarily be enough to, let's say, cement a particular behavior. But I think these 9 months over the last many decades is probably one where consumers have seen a very heightened, you know, trend of adopting new behaviors.
Yeah.
I definitely think that, you know, there have been two kinds of behaviors, and let me kind of break this for you. I think one set of behaviors that we've seen were very paranoia-led, right? They were very short-term, which was more in the, right at the start of the pandemic, you know, where you were obviously being guided by a lot of information from all across, and there was a lot of sort of sense of insecurity, as you said, which is the, you know, which was a more short-term here and now kind of a paranoia. The other set of behavior changes that we've seen, Ashwini, are ones that have kind of now gotten incorporated into people's rituals and very everyday behaviors, right? So the, you know, the focus towards just, you know, knowing and, you know, being more deliberate about washing hands more often is something that's now sort of seeped into people's, you know, people's everyday behaviors. Similarly, the importance of, you know, maintaining hygiene at home. And that's not only from, let's say, COVID viruses, but, you know, in general, maintaining a higher level of hygiene. So I think it'll be important to remember that there were, you know, short-term paranoia-led behavior changes, and then there were behavior changes which have gotten sort of, they've almost penetrated into people's lifestyles. And therefore, it'll be important for brands to now pick up their battles, you know, and pick up their tasks in terms of consolidating, you know, what are those key consumer behaviors that they want to go after. And to answer your second question, yes, I think it'll be very important for brands to look at repurposing themselves or ensuring that the relevance is not very here and now and very, you know, sort of period centric to COVID. And therefore, I think, you know, again, like I said, brands that have managed to make way into a consumer's everyday, you know, routine and regimen are ones that will probably continue to be a part of them. While those, you know, that were very short-term resolves for, you know, addressing anxieties and insecurities may definitely, you know, see a dip.
Right. Jayan, can you come in here? Because, you know, I mentioned Panchamrit earlier. Now, of course, in 2020, it solved a very hygiene-led problem. But again, as we swing from, say, cautious to careless, are you concerned at any level that, you know, people may just, devotees at that, may just go back to the loose version of it, which they didn't have any problem to begin with?
Yeah, I will answer that, because all the five ingredients of Panchamrit are important to our business. But
absolutely,
I'll start to take up from what Anuja mentioned about paranoidness of the consumer and the rituals. And I'll talk to you about this incident, Prashant, it'll be interesting for you. Once this coronavirus broke, Italy was one of the largest first countries in the West which got badly affected. And I've been to Italy last year and have a lot of friends and associates there. So we were checking out with them what's happening and how we're trying to come out of this. So they said, no, there's a lot of people told that we use honey every day, and that's helping us at least remain healthy and fit. Now, I was not a big fan of honey, and I was avoiding it as Jains. In our religion, it's not considered to be a thing which you can have. But then when I said, now this is one product, if Italians are using it and we have honey at home, why don't you try it? So now it's an everyday ritual to take a Dabur honey squeezy in the night, just a few drops, but then it makes you feel good. So that has become a part of the ritual. Having said that, what exactly is an immunity boosting product? So now there are two categories of it. A, when one is focused on the nutrition and the ingredients. So anything you add to any particular product, I mean, be it a probiotic, or be it a vitamins, or the haldi, tulsi, gingers of the world, which go into any of your products, and that is one category. The other category is slightly more holistic, in which people look at boosting overall well-being.
I think Jayan's audio and video is stuck. Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Yeah. Okay. So these are the things. But say in India, for us, it is not just the products which we are mentioning, be it the Panchamruts or the honey, tulsi, ginger, tooth, and so on. See, here what's happened in terms of geophysics language, it's a tectonic shift in the mindset of customers. So more and more people in our country, to achieve the objective A and B, which I mentioned, are moving from loose to packaged products, from commodities to brands, from unbranded to branded, and from local regional brands to reputed and trustworthy brands. Now, this is where the combination of hygiene and immunity comes together. And in a category like milk that we are in, it's a very, very important shift. And it means a lot in terms of the business volumes also. If you give me a minute, I'll explain to you the numbers. Now, milk is India's largest agricultural crop. And the total value of output of milk in India is about 8 lakh crore rupees. It's bigger than most other categories also. Now, we typically in India produce 200 million metric tons of milk in a year, which is about close to 50 crore liters of milk. Now about 30-40% of that milk is retained by the households, rural milk producers who produce it. Then the balance is sold in the open market. So out of that 30 crore liter which comes out in the market, only 1/3 is organized, which is say 10 crore liters, and about 20 crore liters is unorganized. Now this is the low hanging fruit. Now imagine if only 10% of the people who are buying unbranded milk, or lose milk, lose ghee, lose mithai, lose paneer, lose dahi, lose chhas. If they come into the package organized market, it's huge. Now that 8 lakh crores, if you divide it into organized and unorganized market, is about 5 lakh crore rupees. Of which, say Amul is 50,000 crore rupees, the total organized market is 2 lakh crore rupees, and the unorganized, 2 lakh crores, and the unorganized market is 3 to 4 lakh crore rupees. Now, if 10% of that 4 lakh crore comes in, it's about 30, 40,000 crore rupees business. Okay. And of which a large national reputed brand can get half of it.
Right.
So it, up to what you aspire, you can achieve, because what's happened is happened universally, not only within the country, across the world, and it has changed our mindsets cumulatively.
Right. No, thanks for that. That is interesting. So you're saying this kind of transcends the pandemic need, so to speak. The shift from loose to packaged will go beyond the virus related insights. Sure, that's great. Nikhil, come in here, and Prashant after that. Nikhil, I'm very interested in understanding what your worries are, especially on the volumes front, because your product, the UV box, is a high price product. If I'm right, it costs upwards of 8,000 rupees.
Right.
And you compete with the likes of Godrej and Borosil in the same space, and they go as high as, I think, 20,000 plus rupees. So for someone who is swinging back towards a more carefree attitude, what are you going to do to bring her back into your fold? It's a lot of money to shell out.
Absolutely right. So the thing is that, unlike some of the other brands here on the panel, we're not a mass product. Like you said that, this is a product which is a highly priced product. And there is... let me come to Jayan's tectonic shift in the mindset example, right? What has happened is that, our generation or even the generation before, they had just not seen a time like this, right? It's a shift because, and because we've never seen that time, health and hygiene had always, especially in the Indian household, had slipped somewhere behind. If you went to China earlier, even before the pandemic, you would see that everybody who has a cold will move around with a mask on their face, right?
That's
in
right.
India, you'd see them sneezing and coughing and running on the road. I think there is a segment of people who will realize and who are realizing that it's beyond COVID-19, right? We had the flu season when we were fairly okay walking around in the flu season and carrying it back into our household. This change in the mindset needs to be only in the 10%, like Jayan said. If it's in the chain, it's in the top 10% also. I think these products have a much longer lifetime beyond COVID-19. And, whether it's the flu season, whether it's the bacteria, whether you're buying vegetables, you bring them home. It's been now proven that if you just put them under the water, it's not good enough, right? They're carrying bacteria and virus on their surfaces. And you need to have a veggie wash in order to actually get rid of any kind of virus or bacteria. Similar kind of thing, the UV box does it, and it does it without any effort. It does it in 2 minutes time, and it does it without any chemicals.
So minute you say it's a niche product, that explains a lot, Nikhil, because it's like a scaled down version of what used to be associated only at the factory B2B level. And now we have to bring this ultraviolet box into our homes. So when you say niche, that does explain a lot of things.
The thing is that, we were using UV in water purifiers for a very, very long time, right? This is the same technology that is now available for surface disinfection for anything that comes into your household.
Right. Absolutely. Prashant, come in here because I'm not talking about people who anyway had Chyawanprash as a matter of course, the loyalists, so to speak. I'm talking about people who kind of came into your fold this year because of a heightened need for that extra immunity. Are you anywhere worried? I mean, I know you've seen huge volumes and growth, so worried is the wrong word for you. But are you concerned that they may just drop out and fall out of your fold, and Chyawanprash may not remain on someone's shopping list come January?
So we're treating this year this pandemic situation has broken a lot of myths around Chyawanprash, actually.
Hmm.
Okay, so this is so Chyawanprash, right from the month of March itself. Okay, we were of the view, and that's what we always communicated as part of our communication, that Chyawanprash is not a new thing, new thing for Indian consumer. It has been there for last so many years, more than 50 years, And last 10 years, we've been very consistent on our communication related to immunity. And then when they have an immunity specialist, right up, you know, they are aware of this immunity specialist, they should imbibe this as part of their healthcare regime. Now, in so many years, Chyawanprash was always being considered as a product which needs to be consumed only during winters, you know, or during monsoons as such, right? And people had this myth that Chyawanprash is not so useful for consumption during summers. But during these peak summers, May, June, okay, we broke that myth. We reached out to the consumers through different channels, through different, you know, influencers, and told them that, you know, Chyawanprash is equally beneficial in summers as it is in winters. You know, it's about, and the need for immunity is there as much as in summers as in winters. So a lot of consumers started taking Chyawanprash during summers, and now they're clear that, you know, Chyawanprash really helps even in summers as well. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it has broken that myth. Now it has also broken a lot of myths around, you know, who to consume and how to consume. Okay. Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of households who used to think that Chyawanprash is only for the you know, elderlies in the house, or only mm-hmm. for the kids in the house. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, since everyone has benefited from Chyawanprash, now they know it's a family product.
Okay. Yeah?
So it's now an all year round product. It's a family product, and every one of us need it. And, you know, they have understood that there are a lot of people who used to think that, you know, it may not taste good, or my child might not like the taste of it. But all those barriers have been broken. Now, with these barriers being broken, I'm very confident, the team is very confident that we'll continue on this journey. And even at this level, okay, so brand has been there for last 50 years, but Chyawanprash as a category has just 4% penetration in urban India.
Okay.
Just right. 4% penetration. There's so much of headroom for us to continue on this path. It's like, you know, we always draw a comparison with insurance also. You know, everybody understands that insurance is so much important for all of us. Mm. But, you know, what exactly is the insurance penetration in India? It's hardly anything, right? Mm. And even if people are insured, are they adequately covered? So that exactly is Chyawanprash situation. People are aware that Chyawanprash is good for health, but are they really consuming it throughout the year? No, they were not. But now they have understood it, and I'm sure that, you know, will continue on this. A lot of influencers have also helped us break these myths. Government, Ayush Ministry, as also Suman has also said, you know, these KOLs have helped break these myths. Similarly for honey also, you know, honey, Dabur honey, we've been talking about weight management for so many years, right? But we always knew that, yes, Dabur honey also helps in building immunity, right? You are talking about repurposing brand back to, you know, something else, but we are saying we repurposed Dabur honey communication from weight management to immunity building, starting from the month of March. Okay, and now we did a quick dipstick a couple of months back, and, you know, the main reason for new entrance into the honey category is immunity now.
Okay.
Jen also said that, you know, a lot of consumers have experience the benefits of these products, these categories, and not many of them will drop out. Yes, if it is having a positive effect on your health and your lifestyle, they'll continue with it.
Right. Now, Prashant, I'll stay with you since you mentioned honey. You know, we all know what's been happening on that front with the whole purity, focus on purity and the suspicion that's being cast on honey. So I'd like to understand from you, and perhaps Suman and Jayan can also come in because it is related. The question is purity emerging as the third pillar? We're here to discuss immunity and hygiene. But would it be fair to say that purity is now going to become the third pillar of this sort of, you know, triad that's going to become the driving force in 2021? And if yes, which segments is it more likely to touch than others? And I'm guessing milk does come under, you know, might come under suspicion if we're talking about these kind of products. So Prashant and then Suman and Jayan.
No, I'm sure you agree with me. A lot of these categories, actually, the reason behind packaged food products like honey or milk was was purity only, because people were not very confident of the purity of loose honey available in the market. Sure. People were not very sure about the quality of, you know, loose milk being available in the market, right? And that's why they switched to packaged honey, right? Mm-hmm. So, and that was, you know, that was the main reason of the launch of Dabur Honey 35 years back.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I would not call it a third pillar, because a lot of for food categories, such food categories, mm-hmm. Purity is the most important pillar.
Sure, but you know, Prashant, it's not really purity in the sense of loose versus packaged or unorganized versus packaged. It's actually the whole milavat suspicion is now, yes, about the stuff in the bottle.
Yes, so, I'm coming to that. Yes.
Yeah,
I'm coming to that. Yeah, right? I think that the genesis of these brands is based on purity. Right. Now I understand that, you know, there are some media reports in recent times because of which this question has come up, right. So right now I would say that FSSAI, as the apex body in the country, mm-hmm. for the packaged food products, they have laid down specific parameters and control mechanism for to ensure that these packaged foods are 100% pure.
Mm.
Right, as long as the brands are complying with those standards,
yeah,
right, consumer should be fully confident about the purity of the product.
Okay. Jayan, about the latter half of that question, you know, do you see this halo of suspicion kind of extending to categories like the ones you're present in, and what's the future on this front with purity?
I agree with what Prashant says. Purity, mm-hmm. is, when you buy a branded product, be it an Amul or a Dabur or XYZ, I mean, the quality and the purity has to be assured. Okay, there cannot be a doubt in the mind of the customer that this bottle or packet ke andar cheez hai, usme milavat hai. So if the milavat is there, brand have no reason to exist, because that's a fraud we are, anybody would be doing for the customers. So that is where the essence or the message of the brand has to be, that if you buy any Amul product, the trust of that, your trust should be there. I mean, we should be able to develop a blind trust for the brand in your mind. And that should be not just for a packet of milk, but anything which comes under the Amul umbrella or the Amul brand. And so what goes inside the product is the responsibility of the organization. Like we as a cooperative, we work with 36 lakh farmers across 18,500 villages of Gujarat. And as I mentioned, 250 lakh liters of milk is collected, processed and marketed every single day. Now, this is where, as a cooperative, our strength in organizing this entire setup and ensuring and managing quality comes in. And that's where you use technology, there you use the involvement of your members, and all the suppliers of our product are the owners of the brand Amul. So if there is a $7 billion turnover brand, no member who's a cooperative member who's supplying milk would like to cheat his own organization and own brand for the sake of small profit somewhere else. So this is the culture we have to build in. We have to continue to ensure that everybody follows this. But you as a customer, when you buy any product, you should be having a blind trust that if you bought Amul or XYZ brand, then what is written should be there. Right. Having said that, we have a fight against people who replace some of the ingredients and call their products like the frozen dessert versus ice cream, or the butter cookies versus the real cookies, or the vegetable oil cookies, and so on and so forth. So these are the things we try to educate the customers also, that don't get carried away by the category. Please look into the ingredients and buy what you are paying for.
Right. Thanks for that. Now, just to go back to what Anuja mentioned earlier in the conversation, you know, and Suman, come in here, because all of you have been advertising very heavily. So even Nikhil could jump in here. My question is, you know, hand on heart, are we somewhere guilty of reckless advertising nowadays? And I say that, in the nicest way possible, because you have to do what you have to do. But at the same time, there is this Jago Grahak Jago moment happening. And, Prashant, just the other day, this ad, a print ad from the Dabur portfolio kind of blew up on social media for Vedic Suraksha Chai. And, it was being called reckless and irresponsible. So there are very polarizing views on the advertising front. So what's your take on that, as advertisers? What do you think has happened here? And are we guilty somewhere?
So should I go first?
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, I think I'll speak for Hamdard, and what we've done, we did advertise quite a bit on the digital space, but primarily on products which were not so much as, you know, hand sanitizers and stuff like that, but they were more products like Sinkara. We were sort of bringing it back out of the shadows that it was in for a very long time. And that's an energy booster more than anything else. So we looked at Sinkara, and what we did was that we basically played up only the product attributes, but it was the narrative that did the trick of engaging with the consumer. So we had a Sunidhi Chauhan singing a song and stuff like that. And then we moved on to doing something with the Safi, which was a different product. And then with Joshina, which is again a mainstay that, you know, your winter portfolio product, not so much as an immunity story. But the immunity story that we have advertised, and hand on heart, I think what we've really done is that said that this is about a healthy India, and spoken about immunity and respiratory health products, and we just showed them to saying this is what you can pick from, because these are all affordable medicines, and this is what you need to keep yourself fortified. And that's the kind of stuff that we've really been doing. And I don't think that we did anything which was about that, you know, you consume our products and this is going to keep you fighting fit for coronavirus, because a virus is a virus. And we had no story that our brand could really talk about. And I think the only thing that we went aggressive was on a PR campaign, because two of our products had gone into COVID trials. And we wanted those two products, which is Kulzum and Infuser, wanted more and more people to try, because our traditional basket has really got some very blessed products. And, you know, not many people knew about the story. So we were a little tactical in using PR to drive that bit of the story. That's about
That's right. And Prashant, you know, not to single your ad out in any way, but that example is most top of mind. So what do you make of that whole, you know, conversation around the Vedic Suraksha Chai? Because people... See, what the problem that I gather is that people say, don't give us a false sense of security. You know, then we shouldn't feel we're sorted once we eat this or apply this. So what's your take?
So that that was never an intention to give anybody's false sense of security. Okay. Yeah. So it's about enabling consumers to keep themselves healthy. And as Suman has rightly said, that, you know, to make Hello, am I audible?
Lost you at rightly.
Okay, so I'm saying that, you know, as Suman also rightly said, that making claims directly linked to COVID is clearly unethical unless you have specific clinical trials around that, right? So the intention has always been to give consumers a sense of comfort, not sense of complete security. Okay.
Right.
And also keep providing them the solutions which they can use to keep themselves healthy. Now, coming to the specific question related to the print ad on Vedic Suraksha Tea, yes, it was never an intention to make people feel that, you know, this is the panacea of all the kinds of, you know, all the kind of problems you're facing. But yes, we've taken a note. We've taken a note which people have raised, right? And we'll make sure that, you know, going forward, even that specific word, you know, will be used very cautiously. Okay, so it's about, you know, so always consumers' feedback, key opinion leaders' feedback is always welcome. You know, and this was not the first time this ad had come in. Okay, so and you know, the ingredients of this product, okay, are as per the recommendation from Ayush Ministry. So it's not, you know, something which we had made on our own. So we've infused those ingredients with tea. And not just a little proportion of that. You know, if we actually go through the details of the product, you'll figure out that the ingredients have a sufficient quantity to give that kind of benefit.
Sure. Sure. No,
Ashwini, let me come in on the advertising. I'll just mention that, you know, while our product was ready and, you know, we had it in the market, we actually went, you know, our ad did not break till such time that we actually were testing on the COVID-19 virus with the Boston University.
Right.
And till such time that we actually got the clinical results that, you know, the UVC is effective against the virus, we actually held back the communication. Till such time we had that. So as a responsible marketer, I think a lot of our brands are very trusted brands. And I think we've taken all the precaution required before we made any kind of claim to the market.
Sure. Anuja, come in here and I have another question for you. Because, you know, what I see, back to the opening remarks and my preamble, a lot of products, you know, have to struggle now to find place in my, not just my shopping list, but my daily routine. So come in here because you've got this fabric spray. Now, for example, it's an added layer to someone's laundry routine. So going forward, how do you plan to tackle that challenge, and to what extent will advertising help, you know, help introduce that into, or rather keep that in my routine? Or even something like an air spray. I know you compete with Dabur, but actually I think you're competing with the consumer's time and, you know, mind space as well. So,
so Ashwini, let me try and tackle this slightly holistically, right?
Yeah.
See, firstly, I think true to any marketing or product task, and, you know, I think COVID or post-COVID will be no different in that sense. If the product and the brand doesn't talk to the, you know, to the need of the consumer, it'll definitely be out of the consumer's basket. So I think one piece that we've been extremely focused, you know, over the last 9 months has been to actually accelerate our consumer interactions. And we've been spending even more time, you know, and we did a lot of, we used to do a lot of work with consumers, but particularly during COVID, you know, we sort of, you know, made it our go-to approach to, you know, bounce off ideas, to get a very deep understanding into how the consumer trends are changing. And so I think from that perspective, two things have happened, Ashwini. One, it's very important to understand the occasions of use, you know. So for example, air like you spoke of.
Yeah.
And, you know, like I said, even earlier, it's important to understand whether those occasions are very here and now, you know, problem solution approaches, or whether, you know, the consumers are now finding uses for it, which is more holistic and long-term. The second piece is looking at, you know, sort of slightly crystal gazing. I think that is also the task of a marketer to try and build scenarios and say, you know, post-COVID, you know, what are some of the consumers, some of my consumers are likely to go back to their very pre-COVID ways in terms of, you know, almost carefree. While there will be others, you know, who would continue to be fairly watchful of what they're doing. So I think it will be important for marketers, and I think that's, this is really the time as, you know, the next year starts to kick in, to really identify what some of those, you know, very pristine long-term usage occasions would be, and what are some of those, you know, battles or challenges that you'll have to let go. Because I think equally it will be important to be honest and say, you know, this product was really being used, you know, during this particular period of COVID as a, as a, you know, like I said even earlier, as a self-protection model, and may not hold, right? So how are you therefore looking at filling some of those gaps in opportunity? The second question that I did sort of want to touch upon, it's a very interesting topic that you raised around the whole advertising piece, right? I think much like the other pieces in the marketing mix, you know, advertising will have to play a role in terms of bringing the product relevance, in terms of building the needs of the consumers. But I think what will be most important will be the product itself. Fundamentally, what we've seen across all, a lot of our categories has been a lot of quick trials. Eventually, you know, whether or not brands have done a great job of communicating those benefits. Finally, what we're really realizing is that the consumers are falling back on their own experiences with these products. And, you know, I spoke about this even earlier, the trust, you know, that they lay upon, you know, upon brands that have been honest, that have been authentic, will actually carry them.
Now, Anuja, I'm glad you mentioned quick trials, because that's the other part of, you know, the purpose of doing this panel, that what the sampling phase seems to be over. So it's, I'll give you an example in terms of a category that kind of was created or came into its own this year, the vegetable wash category, a specialized solution to clean your apples with. Now Marico launched Veggie Clean and ITC launched Nim Wash and Cavin Care launched Safu. So will they sustain? Will they stick around? That's really the question. So I don't think that's an advertising problem as much as it might be an attitude problem.
I think when a lot of companies were launching the multiple, you know, the plethora of products, they had also known that some of these categories of products will have a shorter life than the others. And I think as a sensible marketer, it'll be important to, you know, put your finger and say that maybe these two or three products had a very short life, right? For example, masks. Masks were really, and we launched masks during the COVID period. And we had known that, you know, this trend may not be something that will continue post-COVID. So it's eventually really a function of whether those categories have seen, firstly, I think post the sampling phase, if the consumers really seen value in those products. Secondly, you know, if they will stand the test of time. So one will have to be honest in terms of assessing them versus trying to shove it down the...
That's right. So now, you know, in conclusion, I'd like your closing remarks, all of you, again, in a minute or so. Just answer the question that's above my head. What next for immunity and hygiene in 2021? Just answer it in a line. You know, what's that one thing that you'd say will take this dual category forward? Immunohygiene. Jen?
This is not going to die away anytime soon, because most of the people have realized the importance of both these things. In food, you see a lot of fads also coming in. I mean, do you know Atkins diet or Zone diet, blood group diet, and so on and so forth. Now, all these things gave instant results, became popular, but then you realize that you were restricting intake of one ingredient, nutrient, and compromising with the other. These became fads. But when you're talking of basic things which affect your life, your living, and your future health, and health of your family, the entire what we call the bubble, these things and all the categories in this will continue to remain relevant. It is up to the brands to see that products are available, they are affordable, premiumization will not matter, because you are now talking to larger masses, and not just the top of the pyramid, but the entire pyramid, including the bottom of the pyramid.
Okay,
Prashant? Yeah, so to me, there will be a new normal for these immunity and hygiene products, right? It's not going to be same as pre-COVID, but at the same time, it will be very important to see, you know, which brands are going to continue the consumer confidence, because, you know, the brands which are really solving the issue of immunity and hygiene, With the right value for money for the consumer is going to continue with the growth trend, right? But if there are brands and the products which were there just for the, you know, as there was a mention about mask, yes, so mask, so people, yes, we were using two to three masks every week, you know, we were buying 2 to 3 masks every week, but that's not going to be the situation going forward. But yes, brands, categories like milk, Chyawanprash, honey, and, you know, to some extent, hand sanitizers, air purifiers, yes, they will find a new normal. And because penetration levels are still at a very low level, consumers have realized the value of immunity and hygiene. They will stick to these products. And products.
Right. Suman, in less than a minute, what next for immunity and hygiene?
You know, something's very interesting that I read the other day, that what is India searching for in Google? So when you look at the data, it's quite interesting. More than 500% searches have been in the areas of health and immunity. You know, that's what India is trying to look at. There have been more than 150% increase in the searches for vitamin C. And incredibly, the figures that come for herbal ingredients, you know, herbs which come with certain health benefits, it's a 380% increased search has gone up in products like ashwagandha, giloy, tulsi, and stuff like that, which just sort of goes to prove one thing, that, you know, immunity boosting products are here to stay, because still ingredient products are not likely to go away, and they find a place in our basket for sure, because even post-pandemic, I think, you know, one thing that we've all learned is that self-care and affordable medicines, which really don't give you side effects and stuff like that, are here to stay, because we are not a pop, you know, pop pill-popping nation that we can keep pills all the time. But these are some which are very easy, and we've all grown up knowing these jadi bootias. And if you put certain solutions, which are easy solutions, they're perhaps here to stay.
Yeah.
Just great. Kada came in our lives, and it's
Kada.
Kada has been there forever. Grandmothers used to us. And we now have it as a protective, health promotive drink. So I don't think that, you know, these are certain things which are going to go away. And if it's a good habit, then why not? I mean, health is going off priority to everybody.
Sure. Nikhil, what next for hygiene?
I think the UVC thing, you know, we had a lot of innovation this year. We actually brought that into homes. For next year, we've actually got a whole lineup planned. This will go into air disinfection in homes, surface disinfection in homes. So I think this year was groundbreaking in terms of just innovation.
Right.
For next year, we now have a whole lineup of products that are going to be launched.
I see. Anuja, what next for hygiene?
No, I would think, Ashwini, clearly, I think hygiene is here to stay, but I think sustainability and a very laser focus, right, on what are the opportunities that you're going after. I think this year has been a little bit of, you know, spraying in all directions for many categories. Next year will be really about consolidating, you know, and going after those 4 to 5 big categories in a very sustainable manner. And I think, like I said at the start of this conversation, authenticity and the trust in a brand will only go, even further from here on. So I think those are two big buzzwords for me.
Sure, great. So the discussion, we can conclude it at that. Thank you. But please stick around. We have the AV coming up. Can we please play the AV?
27 साल आपकी अदालत में आपका साथ क्यों? जब सवाल मुस्कुराकर पूछे जा सकते हैं, चिल्लाने की क्या जरूरत है? जब इरादा सीधे सीधे खबरें दिखाने का हो तो लोगों को लड़वाने की क्या जरूरत है? इसीलिए मैंने इंडिया टीवी पर इन सारी बातों को ध्यान रखा, खबरों में, कमेंट्स में, सवालों में, न किसी को बनाने की नियत न किसी को गिराने की कोशिश। इंडिया टीवी पर शोर कम, खबरें ज्यादा।
Thank you. Just a quick shout out to our audience that has, sent some questions. Apologies to Yaman, Salik, Uday, Yojit, Anjali, and Ronak. We didn't have time to accommodate your questions, but thank you very much for your interest. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, panelists, and have a good evening.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.